everybody. I think this is the last technical talk for the day, is it? There's a keynote afterwards or something? Endnote. Yeah, cool. There's an endnote afterwards. So I don't think I'll take an entire half an hour from you because I'm semester started yesterday, so I've been teaching for 2 straight days. I'm dying inside. I'm Philip Baer, this guy there. I'm a postdoc at the School of Biological Sciences at UWA, which is over there, I think. I'm talking today about bioinformatics in high-performance computing in 2017 based on a few papers that came out in the last few months so that the HPC people know a bit more of what we do, what our needs are, and you guys can see where your low-hanging fruits are for your work. So this is kind of the outline. I want to give a small introduction to genome assembly, which is where I work, where we still have many problems to solve, especially plant genome assembly. I want to show you the scale of the work we're doing. And some at the end, I want to show you some modern concepts, some alternative paths people are now taking, including us, so we don't have to do these massive jobs anymore. So that in the end, I want you to know what the bioinformatics people are doing, so that if you get some other job allocation request from bioinformatics people, you know, aha, I have heard this before in my life. I kind of know what this is. So I got the opportunity to introduce myself. Thank you. So I put the slide in here. So I did my biology undergrad in Germany almost 10 years ago. I finished my PhD a few years ago, and I'm now a postdoc at UWA. We as a group, we focus a lot on crop genomics, crop plant species. We've been involved in the first wheat genome, which was in Science. We've been involved in the first canola genome. And we've been involved in the pangenome of Brassica oleacea, which is cabbage, kale, these salad thingies. We do lots of plant breeding stuff. We work with SNPs, single nucleotide polymorphisms, k-mers, I'll talk about that later, gene presence absence, graph databases, and linking all that to phenotypes, to the way the plant looks like or behaves on the field. And we work in a whole bunch of plant species, because once you get the methods down, it's just sequencing a different individual. So lentil, pea, clover, chickpea, a bunch of seagrasses from the river, wine, wheat, soybean, canola, and we work quite a bit with Bayer Crop Science to help them with their breeding programs. So I'll give you a short introduction to genome assembly, genome sequencing. So just for reference, the human genome, which is in your cells right now, has 3.2 billion letters in it, and these letters are A, T, G, C. Or in biology, we always call these base pairs because you also have an opposite strand, and you always have a pair of sequences together, but we kind of ignore the opposite strand. It's always ATGC, ATGC, ATTT, ATTT for several billion letters. Currently on the market, there are 3 machines people use. There's the Illumina is the biggest company for genome sequencing. They have MiSeq and HiSeq and Xtens and whatever. They are the market leader. They are fairly cheap now. There's Pacific Bioscience, short PacBio. The RS2 is their new machine. They also have an RS1. And then there's the Oxford Minion, which is a very pretty tiny thing. It's just this size, just costs a few hundred dollars. But it doesn't have as much throughput as, of course. For the PacBio RS1, when you bought one, you have to call the architect to make a new floor in your building so it doesn't break it, while the Minion fits into your pocket. The big drawback of them is, cause of all of these machines, is you can't just put your DNA in there and you get the entire DNA back in one piece. They always split them up into tiny pieces. All the Illumina machines give you between 100 to 250 base pairs, so 100 to 250 letters at a time. If you contradict that with the total size of the genome of 3.2 billion letters, there's a big gap there. The PacBio and the Oxford Minion give you much longer reads, so around 10,000 base pairs at a time, but these are very messy. They have a lot of errors, so you spend a lot of time on fixing these errors first. And since we have all these new companies and they keep on inventing and keep on inventing, the costs for sequencing are ridiculously collapsing. This is a graph. If you work in bioinformatics, you've seen this graph a billion times. This is Moore's law here up here, the white line. And this is the cost per raw megabase, so the cost per raw million base pairs, per million letters coming out of your sequencing machine. Up until 2007-ish, this cost was following Moore's law, and then completely collapsed. So we go from $10,000 per megabase to now a few cents per megabase in just 10, 15 years, which is amazing. So, but you still have to assemble that. That's now where the bottleneck is. And there's lots and lots of algorithms for that, and lots and lots of computational approaches. So all of them roughly work like that. You first, you have to clean the noise from your data, because these machines make errors. Illumina machines make less errors than PacBio and Minion machines. But of course, at the cost of that, your reads are much, much shorter. Then you put something like a De Bruijn graph up, try to link all of the data you have, and then you try to find a path through that graph, and that's your genome assembly. That's hopefully a reasonably correct representation of what's actually in the genome, in the cell. So as an example, we have a read, just a very short read, 5 base pairs, A, C, T, D, A, G, and we split that up into K-mers, 4-mers. In this case, I set K to 4, because why not? So in this case, we make vertices and edges of length 3, then K minus 1. So we split that up into A, C, T, first 3 letters, C, T, A, next 3 letters, T, A, G, next 3 letters. And then we just connect them using the edges. Of course, in the real world, you never get one nice big graph and one perfect path through that graph. You have errors in your read, of course, which you have to fix and try to fix as much as possible. Especially in plant species, you have many, many perfectly identical regions. In canola and wheat, we're very interested in resistance genes, for example. And these are often completely perfect copies from each other. So you have like 5 or 6 copies in there. And each copy is a few thousand base pairs long. And if you have 250 base pairs pieces only at a time, you have no idea how many copies you actually have. And there's usually no single Eulerian path through the whole thing. You get a whole bunch of subgraphs, more or less, and then you have to assemble all of them. And this is how an end result looks like on your hard drive. This is a result from one of these graphs. You just get some random number from the assembler. This is Mazurka. And then a whole bunch of letters. These files are then a few gigabyte, just ACTG, all the time. And a few hundred thousand of these pieces. Again, because plants are big. So just to give you a scale of how big plants are, I have this slide. These are gigabase pairs again, billion base pairs. Us humans are down here with our tiny 3.2 gigabase pairs. Rice and chickpea are smaller. But barley is already a little bit less than double in size, and wheat is just massive. And that's the problem with wheat. It's one of the very important crop species, and lots of research is being done on wheat, but every computational job takes forever because it's just so big. This is also reflected in their genes, of course. Here again, us boring humans, 20,000 genes. And here's wheat, 120,000 genes. And rice has 50,000 genes about, and corn, about 30,000. One reason, just in case you want to know, this is because plants, unlike humans, can put several copies of different genomes into one cell. This is called allopolyploidy. So wheat has actually 3 genomes together. That's where the big size comes from. This down here is our bread wheat, and these are all the ancestral species. So we have one big ancestral genome that at some point split into what we call now the A and the B genome. These at some point 5 million years ago merged into the D genome, and then about 0.4 million years ago, all of these genomes came together back into our bread wheat. So again, this is one of the big challenges in assembling these genomes, because often you have no idea where your read comes from. Does it come from the A genome, from the B genome, or from the D genome? And they're all overlap. So up until very recently, we didn't even have a full genome assembly of wheat. We only had like a survey sequence, so something very, very preliminary. So the current status is still that it's quite hard. I want to show you some numbers from this paper, which came out, which was pre-printed nearly exactly 1 month ago. So this is now state-of-the-art bioinformatics. They are the first ones who posted a nearly complete wheat genome. Sorry. So just some quotes from their paper. They have about 1 trillion bases of DNA from the Illumina machine and about 0.5 trillion bases of DNA from the Pacific Biosciences machine. The raw data on the sequence read archive is publicly available. You can go download that. It's about 0.5 terabyte. So not as big as the wave simulation we saw earlier, but it's getting there. And much more repetitive. And to assemble that into one genome assembly is still, it's very computationally very, very hard. They put some numbers, some stats into their paper. The first step of fixing the reads and making the first preliminary overlap took 1.5 months of wall time. And the maximum memory usage was 1.2 terabytes. And then putting it all together, all these preliminary overlaps into one big graph, and then walking through that took a CPU time of 53 years, so 0.5 year of wartime on this cluster, which is, we don't really have that kind of time. But they did it just for the single one assembly. So the whole assembly together took about 6.5 months, and that's without queuing, in case somebody wants to know. That's just wartime. And there was one on the MAIRC in the US at Johns Hopkins. They have a mix of regular nodes with, I think, 64 gig of RAM and high memory nodes with 1 terabyte of nodes of each, but only 50 of those. So as you can see, it's still takes forever, and it still takes a ton of computational power to assemble these genomes, especially plant genomes compared to human genomes. And there's a bunch of shortcuts, but all of them are usually lossy and different approaches. I'll talk a bit more about these later. A genome assembly itself, you can imagine as a kind of lossy compression. You have all this information in your reads, and a lot of it you throw away by just checking the sub-pieces of the reads and then making the graph. So you lose, like I said earlier, if you, for example, have perfect repeats, perfect gene copies, like of my resistance genes, if I have 5 of them, and they're bigger than my pieces of reads, I can't really tell how many copies I actually have, because I don't know. And the final assembly, of course, is not, it's not a perfect representation of the genome. It's just kind of like a shadow of the actual genome in the shell, in the cell. You have errors that get introduced. In my case, my perfect copies usually get collapsed. So instead of 5, I get 1. Hard to sequence regions disappear, or they just get messed up by the assembler because it doesn't know what to do. And for the longest time, all these sequencing companies have been advertising and talking about the $1,000 genome. So because the human genome costs a few $100 million to assemble. But now we are actually at the $1,000 genome, but that does not account for data storage costs, that doesn't account for computational costs. Because places like Beijing Genomics Institute, they have several hundred machines and they can theoretically sequence several hundred terabytes of data per day. The machines themselves are cheap then, but all the data, you have to have a horde of interns to run to, I don't know, Officeworks and buy external hardware just for all the data. And that's one problem we have. We got this box a few months ago from the US. Copying it would have taken way too long. I tried at some point to copy it and I did some calculations that said 2 years. So we just told them to send us a box. This is extracted, this is 80 terabyte of soybean data from the US breeding program of soybean. This is about 600 individuals. This is all they have in the US for plant breeding sequenced. Now, if we look at the last paper and it says it took 50 CPU years to assemble a wheat, I'm not going to go and assemble all of these 600 individuals because that's going to take 250 years of wartime, and then the poor people are going to send me an angry email and say, what the hell is this? People usually don't even do that. If you have 600 individuals, they're not that, their genomes are not that different. What you do is you make one reference individual, and then you take the reads from your other individual, align them with the reference, which is way faster, and then you just check for differences. However, what we've learned in the last few years is that reference individuals are extremely hard to choose, and you often mess up, you often introduce bias because the reference individual is weird. In wheat, the assembly you saw earlier, that's for the cultivar Chinese Spring. We know now that Chinese Spring is just a weird plant in general. I'm not sure it's a bread wheat at all. But it's got a little bit smaller genome than the normal bread wheats you have. And we know now there's about 20, 30,000 extra genes in the Australian bread wheats, which are not in Chinese Spring. So choosing a reference individual is hard, and you may mess up things. And I'm going to quickly skim over a few new approaches that people are starting to use, that I'm using too, which make this whole assembly thing maybe unnecessary, because we don't need it. So I'm going to talk about these 5 things here quickly: computational normalization, pangenome assemblies, population graphs, k-mer comparisons directly, and word to vec. Computational normalization has been around for 2 years, I think. Essentially, what you do is you take your reads, you make a big bloom filter, you split your reads into k-mers, plop these k-mers into the bloom filter, and try to count them. And then, you read in 10,000 reads like that, and the 10,001st read, all the k-mers are already in your bloom filter. You know all the information you can get from that read is already there, so you throw that away completely. And with plant genomes, this kicks out about 80% of my data. But many assemblers use this information also to untangle repeats. So if you have a piece of the graph which suddenly has 100 times more reads than everything else of your assembly, then you know that some repeats, that you have a region which is perfectly collapsed. So this region may be 50 or 200 times more in your genome, you just don't know. And this approach would kick that out, that extra information. And some assemblers do use that. The other approach is a pangenome. We've done that a few times now. We got a few publications out of that. This is again for kale. This is also a new one for Australian breadwheat, where I got that number from, that Australian breadwheats are quite different from the reference. What you essentially do is you have your reference genome, You take your reads from your other individuals, you align them with the reference genome, stuff that doesn't align, that's not represented in the reference genome, you take out and assemble that. In most cases, this is like 5% to 10% of the whole data set you have, which makes things much, much nicer. But however, the downsides are, of course, the reference can be weird, the reference can have errors, and one problem we have, which is more like a conceptual problem, we have nice genes, but in our individuals of interest, these genes are still there, but they're slightly different. They're just different enough so that their reads don't align. But then they show up as new genes in our pangenome, which is, of course, that's not what we want. We want to say these are actually new genes. So that's one of the downsides in that. We probably overestimate how many extra genes there are. One new approach, there's a few companies doing this, is called a population graph. So if you look for a new job, that's something you could think of. This is from Seven Bridges, which is a fairly big bioinformatics company now in the US. What they start to do is make population graphs. So they take all the sequencing data they have, do some of their internal secret algorithmic magic they don't tell you about, and build a big population graph. So each line or each row in this picture here is one human. And this graph shows differences between humans. So all the people down here have a bit of extra DNA the other people don't have. Here, all these people down here have a single extra base pair that these people don't have, and so on. And you can see these are colored by different populations. So these dark blue ones are people from the UK. The light blue ones are people from Finland. And you can see how the human populations differ a little bit. The light blue ones, for example, all have the SNP, the single base pair difference. So the Finnish people have all that, and not a single Finn doesn't have that thing. Again, there's not much software for this out there. There are some companies which are well paid to do that for you. So I can't tell you exactly how much that costs or what the computational costs are because they don't tell you. They do that in-house. The big upside, of course, is it's much less error-prone if you do it all in memory. And downside, it has to be computationally hungry. You saw earlier the graph for one genome. But I'm not sure how much, again, because they don't give you numbers. The other thing, so k-mer comparisons directly. That's one thing where you don't even go for the genome assembly anymore. And that's something I'm doing a lot now. Because data is so cheap, we can get so many reads so quickly, we don't even wait for the assembly anymore. We just sequence a whole bunch of individuals for a few $1,000s instead of a few million like 10 years ago. And then we take the k-mers, so again, we break the reads up into their subpieces, and then we just count them between our groups. And if I see differences between my groups, there's a good chance I don't even have to assemble anything anymore. I can just say, look here, these pieces, they all look like a gene, so this gene must be different between these two populations. This is one paper that came out in, when was that? About 2 months ago. Again, a preprint. This is Hawk. It's a pipeline. It's essentially, you give it sequencing reads from your two groups, case control or disease healthy or elite wild type or whatever. The software then counts the k-mer frequencies in both sets and checks for k-mers that are either unique or way overrepresented in either set, and it makes local assemblies only. So in this case, you just assemble like, I don't know, a few 10,000 k-mers instead of a few billion. In this case, you can see that there's a single base pair difference between these two groups here. And you didn't even have to assemble the whole genome for that. So this is way faster. The last thing I wanted to show you as a kind of example is Work2Vec, which has been taking up some... it's quite rightly used in English parsing, let's just say it simply. It's just a two-layer neural network that learns the linguistic context of words in your training data. So if you give it a big corpus of English text, Shakespeare plays or whatever, it'll learn the context of words. DNA2Vec is a new paper that does the same, but for k-mers in sequencing reads. The nice thing is that you can look at all the k-mers at once, and you can use these embeddings DNA2Vec produces for other machine learning tasks then, once you made them. So you can, in my case, I've been playing around with using these to essentially assign tags to sequencing read data sets. So I have soybean data from the forest, some wild type, and I have soybean data from the breeding company. And I want the artificial neural network to tell me, based on these embeddings, which ones are what, without knowing it at all. And the downside is it's super slow. It takes days just for a single chromosome. This is the paper. That was January this year. And another thing you can do with these things is the TSNE. So this is, I think, I took one human genome and just threw it through Work2Vec and ran TSNE. So you do see some weird clusters, but again, TSNE it's very notorious for giving you weird clusters depending on the settings you use. So these may not be weird clusters. These could also be, it would be really nice if I see some nice genes here that all cluster together, but it may just be completely random. But this, yeah, I've just been doing this a bit on GitHub to play around with that because I don't think anybody else does. So the key takeaways I want to give you is that DNA and genome sequencing is extremely cheap now. Ridiculously cheap. For a few dollars, you can start sequencing on your own. These minions I talked earlier about, you can buy them for yourself for $500. But yeah, the data storage is now the expensive stuff, and the computational power required to look to sift through all this data. That's where we have the bottleneck now. Like I showed you earlier with the plant genome assembly, we still need several hundred thousand CPUs and terabytes of memory to assemble all that, and takes lots and lots of time. But yeah, I showed you a few simple approaches that don't necessitate to assemble the whole thing, which may speed up things for you. They definitely speed up things for me. And there's so many MPI experts in this room. We don't have many MPI experts in the bioinformatics community. So there's lots of low-hanging fruits to optimize assembly algorithms too. I'd like to acknowledge, of course, Pawsey for letting us break their clusters all the time. The Australian government for paying for all this, the AJF for sequencing for us, and the Illumina for sequencing for us too. This is our work group. Jackie and Dave are my supervisors. I've bounced some of this off the Perth Machine Learning Group, which meets every Thursday if somebody wants to come along. That's about it. If you want to know more, you can contact me here or there. This is my supervisor, Dave, and that's my son. I'm not showing him. There's nothing, no connection to the talk. You have to look at him. That's it. If you have any questions, I'm happy to answer.